I'd like to ask you to sit back and remember what it feels like when you get a chance to do something for someone else. It doesn't have to be anything profound or formal, such as volunteer work, but just a time when you were the recipient or the giver of selfless action. I can remember such a time. We were driving in our car out in the country. It was about dusk, and a deer hit our car. And it killed the deer, and it did a lot of damage to our car. The radiator was completely smashed in and was beginning to leak water, so we were trying to get into the next town before our car stopped on us. It was a Sunday night. We pulled into this little tiny town and found a gas station that had someone in it. And the gas station owner told us that he didn't have, of course, the parts that we needed for our car, and he wouldn't be able to order them until the next day. And here we were about 300 miles from home, and I really needed to get back to go to work the next morning. The last bus heading east had just left for the night, and it looked like we were pretty stuck. And then a man who had been watching the whole thing, I guess he was a friend of the gas station owner, came forward and offered to give us a ride home. He said he was on his way home. When we asked him what his destination was, it wasn't anywhere close to where we were going, but he insisted on taking us home, so we let him. It must have taken him about 4 hours out of his way. When we got to our house, we all got out of the truck, and we were shaking hands, and we were thanking him. And we offered to at least, you know, please let us pay for your gas. But he just looked at us and he said, no, just do something good for someone else. And there for a moment, standing in that dark driveway under the stars, we were all enveloped in something greater than ourselves. We were all enveloped in a higher love. But none of us would have felt anything if that truck driver hadn't activated the flow of that love and shared it with us. He was sharing a spiritual life with us. When I talk about sharing a spiritual life, what I'm talking about is that arena that each one of us has inside of us where God's love integrates with our personality. It's where man goes into partnership with God. And each one of us has the ability to express that in our own unique way, unlike anyone else. A Midway creature in the Urantia book tells us that when man goes into partnership with God, great things may and do happen. Sharing your spiritual life with others can vitalize your spiritual growth, and it can let you make a difference in the world. So I'd like to talk to you about sharing your spiritual life with others. And in the process, I want to answer three questions. The first question is, what's the purpose of sharing our spiritual life? Why should we go through the effort and sometimes the discomfort of sharing our spiritual life with others? The second question is, when is it appropriate to share our spiritual life with others? And last, what sort of skills could we use to make our spiritual sharing more effective? Let's take a look at the first question. Why should we share our spiritual life with others? I mean, other than the fact that it feels good, what's the purpose of it? Well, I already talked about the fact that the spiritual life is that area where God's love and our personality come together. In the Urantia book, I would imagine probably everyone's favorite quote for the definition of love is, love is the desire to do good to others. Love brings with it an inherent need to be shared. And it's interesting the way that God has set this up, because you can't feel the full capacity of God's love until you do share it with others. There's another quote in the book that goes something like this. All true love is from God. We receive the divine affection as we in turn bestow it upon others. Love is dynamic. It can never be captured. It is alive, free, thrilling, and always moving. You can never take the love of the Father and imprison it within your heart. God's love can become real to mortal man or woman only by passing through that person's personality as they, in turn, bestow it upon others. The great circuit of love is from the Father, through sons and daughters, to brothers and sisters, and hence to the Supreme. We're going to talk about the Supreme a little more in a minute. But first of all, let's take a look at what this great circuit of love is that's coming from the Father. The best way that I know how to describe that circuit of love is to compare it to the way that a light bulb works. Now, we all know that a light bulb has these two little filaments of wire that are connected by another piece of wire. The current comes up through this filament of wire, passes over to the other one, and you have light. If there was only one piece of wire, the current would have nowhere to go. It would be incomplete. The circuit would be interrupted, and you'd be in the dark. In very much the same way, the Father's love works. We have to allow that circuit of love to pass through us and onto someone else before that circuit becomes complete. We can't stop it here. Like the quote says, the love is always moving. So you can't stop it in your heart. You can't imprison it there without passing it on to someone else. So then a lot of the purpose of sharing your spiritual life is, for one thing, that's what God's love was meant to do, was to be shared. And the other thing is, you can't feel God's love in its fullness until you do share it with someone else. Let's go back to the Supreme. What is this thing called the Supreme? Why does the Urantia book keep talking about it? Well, in a nutshell, in a small nutshell, the Supreme is that part of God that is evolving in time and space like we are. And when we share God's love with other people, when we have experiences, very often they become experiences of the Supreme. So in other words, when I have an experience, I'm contributing to the growth of God in this universe age. When you start making your decisions based on that realization, you begin to develop something that the Urantia book calls cosmic consciousness, or universe citizenship. And that, according to the Urantia book, is the mark of a maturing human being. So the purpose of sharing our spiritual life, as I see it, is threefold. First of all, God's love was meant to be shared. Secondly, you can't feel that love until you do share it. And third, we have a responsibility to contribute to the growth of the Supreme. Let's take a look at the second question. When is it appropriate to share our spiritual life with other people? Sometimes we take the term spiritual life and we compartmentalize it over here in a little section of our lives, and we think that it's got something to do with the times that we invite someone to a study group or tell someone about Jesus or even share with someone about all the bright lights that were floating around in our head this morning during meditation. But the truth of the matter is, when we limit our experiences of spiritual life in that sense, we're missing out on the point that every moment of every day contains the opportunity to share our spiritual life with others. We always have a choice on how we want to share or how we want to respond to life. We can respond with integrity, we can respond with love and honesty and consideration for the other person, or we can respond off the top of our heads. And very often we do that because we get in a hurry. And I think sometimes that's the biggest barrier we have. Let me show you as an example of what spiritual life looks like in my household when I'm sharing it, when I'm in a hurry and when I'm not in a hurry. Let's say my son Peter has just come home from school and he's forgotten his homework again. This isn't the first time he's forgotten his homework, and it's his science homework, and this isn't the first time he's forgotten that. Now, let's say I've got an appointment that I have to go to and I'm in a hurry. So Peter comes in and suddenly I find out that he's left his homework at school again. How am I going to respond to that? Well, I can respond like this. You know, Peter, I don't believe this. I mean, you don't have that much in life to worry about. Why can't you remember your homework? Now I'm going to have to take you back over to the school. You're going to have to get your homework. I'm going to be late for my appointment. I don't believe this. If we don't get back in that school building before it closes, you're grounded for the rest of the week. Sometimes when I'm in a hurry, that's the way I sound around my house, because I respond off the top of my head. I don't stop to pause and activate that flow of God's love and share my spiritual life with others. Now, if I did stop to pause and activate that flow, I might find out that Peter doesn't like science, but he feels like his questions in class are stupid, so he's afraid to ask anything. Maybe he's embarrassed about it and he just wants to forget the whole thing. Then my response would be a little bit different. It may go something like this. You know, Peter, when I was your age, I hated math. Oh, I was so bad at it. I know just how you feel. Listen, I've got to go to an appointment, but I'm going to drop you off at the school. Go get the homework, and when I come home, we're going to work on it. And I know you can do it, so don't worry about it, okay? We always have the opportunity to share our spiritual life with others because we've always got a choice on how we're going to respond to life. We can respond with love, or we can respond off the top of our heads. It's up to us. So when do we share our spiritual life? Anytime. Let's take a look at the third question. What sort of skills do we need to share our spiritual life with others? You know, sometimes I think we don't even consider this when we're looking at a spiritual life. It's something spiritual. There's skills we're supposed to be using for this. But the truth of the matter is, if you're not good at something, you're not going to try to do it. For example, when I first moved to Colorado, I found out that my husband and my two stepsons loved to ski. So I went with them for a couple of times. And after a few times, I came up with a lot of reasons as to why I didn't like to ski. It was a long drive into the mountains, it was cold, the lift lines were long. But the truth of the matter is that when I got up to the top of the mountain and looked down that slope, I just knew I was going to end up embedded in someone's car in the parking lot. I didn't have the skills I needed to ski, so I didn't want to try it. But now, after a few years and a few lessons and skiing with John, I feel a little bit better about it, and I'm more willing to try it. The same thing happens with your spiritual life. If you're not developing skills to be able to do that something well, you're not going to try that something. Intention's not going to get you there either. Stephanie Marston was a real estate agent. Excuse me, not Stephanie Marston, Candy Leitner. Candy Leitner was a real estate agent whose life was dramatically changed in 1980 when one of her children was struck and killed by a drunk driver. It became even more of a tragedy when she found out that the driver had only been out on bail for a couple of days after being involved in another drunk driving accident. What started at that moment was the beginning of an idea that became a national phenomenon. You probably have heard of MAD, Mothers Against Drunk Driving. It's really due in a major part to Candy Leitner's involvement with getting out there and trying to tell people that things needed to be changed. Now, what would have happened if she had never developed any skills for getting in front of Congress, for getting in front of large groups of people to try to convince them that things needed to be changed? What if she had only relied on her intention and her ability to talk as if she was talking across the kitchen table to some of her neighbors? If she had never developed the skills that she needed to communicate well, MAD may never have happened. Even Jesus took the time that it was required of to really work on developing the skills to share his spiritual life with someone. I want to read you a couple of quotes that tell you how Jesus did that. The Urantia Book, page 1424. The Son of Man, during the time and through the experiences of this tour of the Roman world, practically completed his educational contact training with the diversified peoples of the world of his day and generation. By the time of his return to Nazareth, through the medium of this travel training, he had just about learned how man lived and wrought out his existence on Urantia. Again, the Urantia Book, page 1427. On this Mediterranean tour, Jesus spent about half of each day teaching Gaenad and acting as interpreter during Gaenad's business conferences and social contacts. The remainder of each day, which was at his disposal, he devoted to making those close, personal contacts with his fellow men, those intimate associations with the mortals of the realm which so characterized his activities during these years that just preceded his public ministry. When he had time, he got out there and he developed the skills that it took to share his spiritual life with other people. So let's identify some of those skills that it takes to be more effective at sharing our spiritual life. When I am trying to work on my skills for effective spiritual sharing, I try to remember three words. I call them the three L's, and they are listen, love, and leap. These three words constitute the scaffolding for the skills that you can use to be more effective at sharing your spiritual life. Let's take a look at the first one, listen. Now, some of you may be surprised that listening is a skill because you're listening now. We all listen all day long. Most of us have two ears that work reasonably well. But the truth of the matter is, we do a lot of things other than listening when we're supposed to be listening. What do? We think about what we're going to say when the other person stops talking, or we think about why they're wrong and we're right, what we have to get at the grocery store, we watch television. We're not very good listeners. And listening is really important if you're going to share your spiritual life with other people, because you've got a lot to learn about someone before you can appropriately share with them. There is a technique called active listening that has a couple of skills in it that I'd like to talk to you about. You've probably heard of active listening, but before I talk to you about them, I want to mention something. In a book called The 7 Habits of Highly Effective Living, Stephen Covey has a chapter called Seek First to Understand. And in this chapter, he also talks about the skills of active listening, but he makes a very important point, which is, if you're really not interested in what the other person has to say, don't bother with the techniques, because the other person is going to resent the fact that you're manipulating them. And that's exactly what you'll be doing unless you're actually interested in listening to them. So let's assume you really want to listen. The first skill in active listening is something called feeding back, or paraphrasing. And it looks something like this. My friend says, "Oh, I'm so mad at Bob." And I would say, "Boy, you're really angry with Bob." Now that may seem pretty simple and pretty silly, but let's take a look at what I might respond with instead. My friend says, "Oh, I'm so mad at Bob." I would probably say, "You know, I'm mad at Bob too. He was supposed to be over here yesterday at 7 o'clock to help me move the piano. He didn't even show up until 9:30. You see the difference? Feeding back can really keep you centered on what the other person is having to say. The second skill under the technique of active listening is to respond to feelings and meanings rather than just responding to the words. As an example, I'm going to ask Joan to help me show you what that looks like in real life. Let's say, for the sake of pretend, Joan and I work in an office building together, and we take our lunch every day in the company cafeteria together. Joan's going to show you what it looks like when she responds to, well, not much when I'm talking, and the second time she's going to respond with the techniques of active listening. Oh, boy, Joan, I'm so tired all the time.
I know why you're tired.
Really?
Yeah, I see you every day here eating that junk food, gloppy donuts,
I don't think that's
Snicker
it, Joan.
Bars, Cokes. You've got to eat right in order to feel good.
Okay, as you can tell, we didn't get too far on this. Now let's try it again, and Joan's going to use the techniques of active listening. Oh, boy, Joan, I'm just so tired all the time.
Why do you think you're so tired?
I don't know. You know, I just keep getting all of this work piled up on my desk, and it seems like the more I get out, the more I've got, and I don't know. It's just a lot of work.
You seem to be overwhelmed.
I am overwhelmed. And you know that prospectus I was working on last week for Bob? I stayed after work every day and worked on it, and I finally got it done, and when I handed it to Bob today, do you know what he said to me? He said, "Here, get this memo out before the next meeting tomorrow."
Bob doesn't appreciate all the hard work you're doing.
No, he doesn't appreciate the hard work I'm doing.
Maybe you should have a little talk with Bob.
Yeah, you know, I think I'm going to have to. When you use the techniques of feeding back and paraphrasing and responding to the feelings and meanings rather than just responding to the words, you get a chance to really understand what the other person is trying to say to you. The first L is listen. The second L is love. The attitude that you have when you enter an experience of spiritual sharing is going to make or break your experience. How many times have I heard myself or someone else that I know saying, "Oh, this person could really use some stuff out of the Urantia book." We really need to develop an attitude of receiving instead of giving, which is strange because you're the one who wants to share. But you've got a lot to learn about someone before you can share with them, as I've said before. So the first skill to develop under the context of love is to receive the other person with openness and to respect the person that you find there. It's not fair to compare people to what we think they should be. And it's not fair to put a pre-existing judgment on someone. And it's also not fair to not respect someone based on what their station in life is or what they look like. Not receiving the other person with openness is a real drag on the other person, too. I can remember when I was younger, I was a waitress in a restaurant. We had a manager who called us girls. I mean, he never knew any of our names, and I can remember even a couple of times standing by myself and him walking by and saying, "Good morning, girls." I mean, it was like me, and he was calling me girls. It was so ridiculous, I couldn't get very upset at it, but it's just a good example of what happens when you don't receive another person with openness. And when you find the person that you're receiving, you need to respect them. There's a really great story about a very great rabbi who was coming home on the train, and he couldn't find a place to sit except in the smoking car. So he sat down and began to read his paper next to a group of men who were playing poker. After a couple of minutes, one of the men who was playing poker looked up and said, "Hey, old man, I was doing really well until you got here. You're bad luck. Get out of here." The rabbi ignored him, continued to read his paper. A few minutes later, the man got up and said, "Listen, old man, did you hear me? I said you're bad luck. I want you out of here." He picked the rabbi up by the collar and pushed him into the other train car. A couple of weeks later, the rabbi was delivering a sermon at his synagogue. And after the sermon, he was standing in the back greeting people. And who should come up in the receiving line but the man who threw him out of the car? The man looked at the rabbi and said, "Rabbi, I am so sorry. I had no idea it was you. Please forgive me." And the rabbi looked at him and said, "My son, I can't forgive you." A couple of weeks later, the man returned again and said, "Rabbi, please, I feel so terrible. Please, I beg your forgiveness." The rabbi said, "I'm sorry. I can't forgive you." The rabbi's son was standing nearby and asked him why he couldn't forgive him. After hearing the whole story, he said, "I don't understand. Why won't you just forgive this man?" The rabbi said, "Son, this man insulted a poor, helpless old man. He's asking forgiveness of a great rabbi. Until he seeks out the poor, helpless old man, I can't forgive him." We need to respect everyone, regardless of who they are. Receive people with openness, and be respectful of the person you find there. Jesus was so good at this. His willingness to see people for who they really were and his total respect of everyone he found gave him the ability to be received into people's hearts so well and to communicate with them on the level that they were on. We all need to do that more often. The second skill to develop under the context of love is this: develop your faith in people. Faith breeds faith. Faith is such a powerful thing. When someone knows that you believe that they can overcome their difficulties and they can realize their dreams, then you've given that person a great gift. I have a story about faith that I'd like to share with you that comes from my own life. When I was very young, I was married to a man who had a wonderful family. His mother was a beautiful, spiritual Christian woman. I went down to visit them by myself once, shortly after we were married. And my sister-in-law invited me to go to the beach. We had to be back early that evening because my mother-in-law had invited some of her friends over to meet me. So we took off for the beach, stopped and got some sandwiches and a bottle of wine. And we sat on the beach and ate our sandwiches and drank our wine, and we walked up and down the beach and talked and drank our wine, and we sat in the sand and drank our wine. This was before I really knew how to drink or knew how I shouldn't be drinking. I got really soused. And I came home, walked in the door. These wonderful smells were coming from the kitchen. My mother-in-law had been cooking all day. The table was set with the good linen and the good china and the real silverware. Everything was ready for the guests, except me. I was standing in the living room, sort of grinning and swaying at everyone, and that was about all I could do. So my sister-in-law and her husband picked me up, took me into the bedroom, put me on the bed, and pulled off my boots, and I proceeded to pass out. I don't know what my mother-in-law told her guests, but I wasn't there to find out. The next morning, I woke up with a terrible hangover, but nothing close to the faux pas that I had created in that family. I was so terror-stricken over what the response was going to be from my new in-laws, and I felt like I was about that big. So I stumbled into the kitchen where my mother-in-law was sitting at the kitchen table doing her Bible study, and I said, "I don't know what happened last night," and she jumped right in and said, "Well, I do. You just haven't been eating enough." And that was it. I was completely pardoned because I hadn't been eating enough. Never mind the fact that I had ruined her dinner party. Never mind the fact that she had to make up some excuse for me, for her friends, and that I had gotten drunk in her house. All she cared about at that moment was restoring my self-respect. Can you imagine what that did for a really stupid 21-year-old? I wanted to be that person. She believed in me. Develop your faith in people. It's a great gift. Stephanie Marston is a child psychologist, and she specializes in teaching parents how to develop self-esteem in their kids. And one of the things she says is that we're really good about being believing in our little kids, but as they get older, we suddenly begin to find that they've got a lot of faults, and as a matter of fact, we spend a lot of time pointing out their faults. She says, can you imagine what would happen if your baby was learning to walk and you said, "Look at you. You've fallen down 5 times today. You're never going to get this right." We don't do that. The minute your kid takes his first step, you call up every relative in the country. It's great news. So why can't we be like that with our older kids? Why can't we be like that with each other? We've got to develop our faith in each other. It doesn't mean you have to believe in things that aren't there. It just means that we need to concentrate more on the goodness in others. The first L was listen. The second L was love. The third L is leap. Take that leap. Commit yourself to action. No matter what your intentions are, no matter how you feel about someone, if you don't share your spiritual life with someone else, it's never going to happen. I think one of the biggest reasons that we don't share our spiritual life with others is because we're afraid we're going to be rejected. Fear of rejection is a biggie. One of the best examples I know of how this is shown in life is when someone goes through a divorce or has a death in the family. Oh, sure, friends are there for the first couple of days, but after a while, they seem to kind of fade into the woodwork. And when you ask people why they're not being there for these people that they love, they'll say things like, "Well, I don't want to say the wrong thing and make matters worse," or, "I don't want to appear nosy or meddlesome." The truth of the matter is, we're afraid to walk into a situation where we know there's need and not be in control. We've got to trust God to take care of our needs so we can focus on someone else's needs. We've got to believe that God is going to maintain our feeling of self-worth, even if we end up with egg on our face. We've got to let go of our ego so that we can share our spiritual life with other people. We've got to take that leap. A while back, I was in a prayer group in my church, and it met every Thursday morning. And every Thursday morning, this very elderly woman would show up in a wheelchair, and she'd transfer to a walker, and then she'd finally get in her seat. It was a very precarious operation. She was a wonderful woman. She had a very keen mind and a really wonderful wisdom, and I really enjoyed talking to her after the meeting was over. But when it came time to get her out of that chair and move her back into the wheelchair, I got lost because I don't know how to do that sort of thing, and it was awkward. I didn't feel comfortable with it. What I was really telling her was, "I really like what you have to say, but I'm not comfortable with the fact that you're an invalid." One morning, we talked for so long there was no one else to help her, so I had to. And surprisingly enough, we got through it okay. And it really made me realize that this sort of stuff happens all the time. We stop ourselves from sharing our spiritual life with people. We stop ourselves from having a complete relationship with people because we're afraid that we're going to be rejected, or we're afraid that we're going to do something wrong. We've got to get rid of that. We've got to trust God to take care of us and take that leap of action. Without that leap, nothing else is going to work. Listen to what people are saying to you. Develop an attitude of love and take that leap of action. These three skills can be applied to even the most ordinary of situations, And I don't know about you, but my life is full of ordinary situations. You know, I wish sometimes that God would blind me on the road to Damascus and give me some big life mission, but I don't think that's going to happen. I think what God wants me to do and what He wants you to do is to allow that love to flow through us and then integrate into our personality, where we can then turn and share that spiritual life with the rest of the world. Dare to share. It invigorates your spiritual growth and it gives you a chance to make a difference in the world. I'd like to close with part of a poem by Michael Hanna that talks about just how much these small, ordinary situations can make a difference when we show love. For love is lavish when rendered in small ways, and each of us profits or suffers in measure with all of us. Forever will these little opportunities to love that daily drop into our hands abundantly satisfy the question, Lord, what will you have me do? Thanks.
Hello, my name is Paula Thompson, and I would like to share something with you that is very, very dear to me, and that is the Urantia book. I've been reading the Urantia book for a great many years now, and I've read it several times from cover to cover, and I actively read and study it on an ongoing basis. It would be nearly impossible for me to share the entire Urantia book with you in such a short amount of time. Therefore, I would like to share something, a topic out of the Urantia book, which is very dear to my heart, as I'm sure it is to most people, and that topic is love. The Urantia book has a good deal to say about love. In fact, I think that every word in the book is woven in a tapestry of love. It's so obvious to me that the beings who brought us this book loved us enough to give it to us. The Urantia book has some interesting insights in love, and perhaps you're thinking, what could the Urantia book possibly tell me about love that I don't already know? I know that I want love. I know that I need love. I know that most people in my life want and need love. What else do I need to know? But you might be surprised to find out that the Urantia book has some thought-provoking definitions of love. Just to give you one example of that, the Urantia book says that fear is the opposite of love. You've probably been thinking that hate was the opposite of love, but no, fear is the opposite of love. One thing I would like to accomplish in this talk is bring out two key points, to me, insights from the Urantia book that I find invaluable. One is that love is not merely a feeling or an emotion. Love is a divine dynamic force that has the ability to transform not only individual lives, but even the very world in which we live. And the other key point that I would like to make is it is not only our obligation and our duty, but our divine privilege to love one another. This is the essential message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There are several definitions in the Urantia book about love. One, for instance, is that God is love, but love is not God. Sometimes we can better understand something if we look at its opposite. And I mentioned before, something that struck me is that fear is the opposite of love. And when you think about that, fear is something that brings up a whole bevy of negative emotions in most people, whereas love is the cause of a great many positive emotions and wonderful emotions. Fear can cause anxiety and stress, anger, jealousy. Love brings about trust, loyalty, devotion, sympathy. Divine love, the Arendt book teaches us that there are two types of love. There are what we call a human love, which is more of an emotion, and then there is a divine love, which is the Father's love. The Arendt book teaches us that love is an attitude. Love is an active word. The Arendt book also says that love is the true desire to do good to each other. So we learn that love is something we must do. It's not just a feeling we have, but it's a response. It's dynamic, it's active. So we go out into the world and we project love onto our fellows. And this love, as I said before, has the power to transform these individuals. And through these individuals, who then in turn give love to other individuals, we have the power to literally transform our world. I'd like to draw on a personal experience in this way. And the experience was an experience that was shared to me by my own grandmother. She was probably one of the most loving, kind, gentle, sincere, real people I have ever known in my life. And she had a profound effect on me as a child. And I used to ponder why my grandmother was the way she was. And the reason I did was because I knew a little bit about her background. In fact, we had spent many hours talking about her childhood and how she was raised. And it's an interesting story. My grandmother came across the prairie in a covered wagon, to give you some idea about when she was born and the life she lived. And when she was a very young child, 3 years of age, her father and mother and her baby brother and baby sister moved into a log cabin. Through a twist of fate, they all came down with tuberculosis. My grandmother and her father were the only people to survive. Her mother, baby brother, and baby sister all died. She was left with a man who was a hardworking man, a good man, but not even prepared to raise a child, and through a marriage of convenience was left to be raised by a stepmother who literally hated her. And this woman would stop at nothing to make her life miserable. In fact, she went out of her way on many occasions. And just to give you an example of some of the severe child abuse that my grandmother suffered as a child at the hands of her stepmother, once when she was about 8 years of age, she came in the house and the wind grabbed the door and swept it out of her hands and slammed it behind her. And my grandmother was a very small person, always. And her stepmother accused her of slamming the door and took a wooden shuttle off of the loom, the household loom, and got her down on the floor and beat her so hard that she literally broke her hip with this wooden shuttle. My grandmother, as long as I knew her, was crippled because of this injury that she suffered as a child. Her stepmother told her, "If you tell your father what happened, I'll kill you." So she believed, after what had just occurred, that her stepmother probably would kill her, and so she never told. She took that secret to her grave. Another incident, when she was a small child, she collected birds' eggs, and she collected nests, and she would put the eggs, she would mount the eggs in the nest on a board, and she would label them. And this was her hobby, this was her pastime, and this was something she loved dearly. Her stepmother got mad at her one time and threw the entire collection into the fire. One of the things that my grandmother said to me, she said, "Paula, I wept blood." The abuse she suffered at the hands of her stepmother was so cruel and so unkind. And I used to reflect as a child, even as a child, how did my grandmother turn out the way she was? Well, it's also true that even though she had to live with this stepmother and a father who was fairly disinterested in the whole state of affairs that was happening in her life, she also had a grandmother not far from her house, her mother's mother, who cherished her and loved her. And not only her mother's mother, but her mother's brother, her Uncle Ned. And periodically, maybe two or three times a year, she could go to this home of her grandmother and her Uncle Ned, and they would lavish love upon her, and they would give her affection and attention and all of the wonderful things that every child needs to have to grow to be a healthy, normal individual. So by contrast, although she had to live with a stepmother who hated her and the unfairness of having lost her own mother as a small child, she also had this beautiful, sincere, kindly, older lady who lavished love and affection upon her, and also this wonderful man who lavished love and affection upon her. And this love, I believe, is what saved my grandma. This distinct contrast between love and hate, and the ability to say, gosh, this love feels good, carried with her all through her life. And I know that it was probably the one thing that she was determined in her life to show to others, and that was this real and divine love. The Urantia book teaches that real love is unconditional. We're so used to putting conditions on our love. We're so used to saying, I will love this person if they do this, 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 and this for me. Or I will forgive this person up to a point, but I will never forgive certain things. Well, this was the essence of Jesus' gospel, I believe, when he said that we should love each other even as he loved us. Because the way he loved us was with a parental affection. And no love comes closer to the divine love or God's love than that parental affection. People who have children can understand this best of all, I think, because they realize the depth and scope of this love. There's literally nothing that a child could do that the parent can't forgive. Most often the parent has undying faith and belief in the child's ability to supersede and to be good. And I think that, to me, that experience of parenthood has taught me more about the love that the Heavenly Father has for me than any other experience I've ever had. It's very important that we heal each other with this love. This love truly does have the power to heal ourselves as individuals and heal our world. In fact, I think, and the Urantia book tends to draw this conclusion as well, love is the one thing, the most important thing that we can do for each other and for our world. Because love is our salvation, the Father constantly pours love out upon us. And we have to begin to see ourselves as receivers. The love is there, it's all around us. And we begin to learn a perception of the real world, the way the world really is. And the real world is pervaded by this love of God. It's in everything we do, the air we breathe, every move we make. We are literally alive in the mind of God. We are literally alive in the love of God. We're the ones that prevent ourselves from giving this love to each other. We're the ones that stop the flow of the love from the Creator through us and into other individuals. We can open ourselves up to this love. We can become what I like to call a divine conduit of love. The love flows into us and into our fellows, and through our fellows into other individuals, and eventually the whole of mankind, the brotherhood of man, will experience this love of God. God loves us in a spiritual sense. But he can't give us a hug or a kiss in a material sense. And this is what we do for each other. We express God's love to each other generally through material terms. So when the Father's love comes into us, it's so much better to express it at that point. I always think that love unexpressed is like a beautiful work of art, a Rembrandt painting that a person hides in the closet. If you don't express God's love, then you're doing a great disservice to yourself and to the person you love. The Urantia book teaches us that it is not so important that we feel love for everybody, but that we learn to love another individual all the time. And one of the most important things that the Urantia book says to me about love is that we have to know a person to love that person. Well, gee, that makes sense. I've found that to be true in my life, and I'm sure you have all found that to be true. You do have to know a person to love a person. But if you keep in mind that love is an attitude, a loving attitude, then you'll find it a great deal easier to love people and to get to know people. One of the most essential ingredients to knowing a person is being able to forgive that individual for the little idiosyncrasies about that person that you find troublesome or disagreeable. To be able to overlook those things, and to me, Jesus, the Master's prayer, the Lord's prayer, where he says, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. That's sublime to me, simply because Jesus knew that in this struggle of this world, we would trespass against each other. We would invade each other's space. We would step on each other's toes. We would say things to offend each other and do things to offend each other. The most essential thing that we can do is forgive those little indiscretions and look beyond that and learn to love one another and learn to know what motivates each other. I had an experience along these lines, and I believe it's important to begin with yourself. Charity begins at home, that's an old saying, and it's very true. If you have a relationship in your life that is troublesome or bothersome, perhaps even a relationship that you would consider one of hate, make it a personal mission to change that relationship around, to change that relationship into a loving relationship. And if you do, if you succeed, you will personally know the miraculous power of love. I had an experience like this in my life. I wasn't very close to my sister-in-law, my brother's wife. In fact, I would say at one time I even hated her. And I'm not that kind of a person, and I wasn't happy with those feelings, but they were there and they were real. And I found myself entertaining ideas of hate that I wasn't accustomed to. And I know that hate is a spirit poison. The Urantia book teaches that hate is a spirit poison, and I actually felt that poison working in my life. And I felt that bitterness and that anger coming forth because of the bad feelings that I had for this woman. And I got to a point where I wouldn't associate with her or with my own brother. Family get-togethers were very strained and very difficult because of my hateful attitude towards her. And at that point, I was reading the Urantia book, and in spite of all the beautiful, kind, loving, forgiving things the Urantia book was teaching me, I still held on to my hate for this person. And I was in a public park one day and talking to somebody, and my little niece came running up to me and hugged me and was so glad to see me and so full of joy and happiness and childhood enthusiasm. And I immediately started looking around for my brother and his wife, because I knew if my niece was there, my sister-in-law and my brother wouldn't be far behind. And my eyes met my sister-in-law's eyes. And in that very instant, I saw so much pain. She literally, the look that I read in her face was, "Gosh, Paula, I want to come up to you and I want to hug you too. And I want you to love me. But I know I can't because you hate me." And something touched my heart that day, and I said to myself, "You can't do this to this woman. Sure, she's made mistakes. Sure, she trespassed against you. Sure, she hurt you. But you can't hold on to this hate. You have to let it go. You have to forgive her and love her because she wants your forgiveness and she wants your love." And I made it a personal mission to forgive my sister-in-law. And I put what happened in the past where it belonged. I put it in the past. And I began to change that relationship around. I began to lavish love upon her and attention. Every time she would come to the house for a family get-together, I would single her out. I would sit with her and we'd have a conversation. And I began to, in as much as I had campaigned against her to my own mother and my sister, and I had gotten my family pretty much all to be against her, I began to do just the opposite. I began to tell them what really a loving person she is and a good person she is. And I think I changed their perspective towards her, and I opened a door of love for them, and I opened a door of love for myself. And I began to see that my sister-in-law was just growing and changing like all of us. And I learned to love her. And I'm very proud to say that she's one of my dearest friends now. And I cherish this woman. She's a lovely, wonderful woman. So it's not that she wasn't a good person. It was that I wasn't allowing the love from God to flow through me into her. I was holding on to my anger, and I was holding on to my hate. And I did her a great disservice, and I did myself a great disservice. And I also did all of creation a great disservice. Because when there is love between two individuals, then that's where Jesus is as well. And that love has the power to transform our world. If I could, I would love to read one of my very favorite quotes from the Urantia book on love. And I'll end my talk with this. You can find this quote on page 1098. And it's from the third section of the book called The History of Urantia. This is the quote. "In the mind's eye, conjure up a picture of one of your primitive ancestors of cave-dwelling times. A short, misshapen, filthy, snarling hulk of a man, standing legs spread, club upraised, breathing hate and animosity as he looks fiercely just ahead. Such a picture hardly depicts the divinity and dignity of man. In front of this animated human crouches a saber-toothed tiger. Behind him, a woman and two children. Immediately you recognize such a picture stands for the beginning of much that is fine and noble in the human race. But the man is the same in both pictures. Only in the second sketch are you favored with a widened horizon. You therein discern the motivation of this evolving mortal. His attitude becomes praiseworthy because you understand him. If you could only fathom the motives of your associates, how much better you would understand them. If you could only know your fellows, you would eventually fall in love with them. You cannot truly love your fellows by a mere act of the will. Love is only born of thoroughgoing understanding of your neighbor's motives and sentiments. It is not so important to love all men today as it is that each day you learn to love one more human being. If each day or week you achieve an understanding of one more of your fellows, and if this is the limit of your ability, then you are certainly socializing and truly spiritualizing your personality. Love is infectious, and when human devotion is intelligent and wise, love is more catching than hate. But only genuine and unselfish love is truly contagious. If each mortal could only become a focus of dynamic affection, this benign virus of love would soon pervade the sentimental emotion stream of humanity to such an extent that all civilization would be encompassed by love. And that would be the realization of the brotherhood of man. Thank you so much for letting me share these things with you today. I certainly appreciate your time. God be with you.